What is up, everybody? I think it's finally time for us to put our feet on the ground, so to speak. Since our terrain is simply a grid of triangles or quads on the x and z axes, and the height or the y value of each vertex is coming from a height map, this basically means constraining the height of the camera to the height from the height map. Remember that the height map is discrete, which means that we only know the height at the vertices of each triangle, and when the GPU finally renders the triangle, the height of each fragment is interpolated. If the camera is located directly on a vertex, then problem solved. We know exactly the height at this point. But when the camera kind of moves from vertex to vertex, in order to constrain it to the ground, we need to manually interpolate the heights using the height map. By default, the distance between neighboring vertices on both the X and Z is one unit, but we have this notion of a world scale, which allows us to scale this one unit up or down and basically control the size of the terrain. This is something that we need to take into account in our calculations. Okay, so we start with the camera positioned at XC and ZC, and these coordinates are probably fractions. For now, let's just assume for simplicity that the world scale is 1. What we need to do is to find the 4 neighboring cells in the height map of the quad where the camera is located. This is very simple. We just need to truncate the fractional part of the coordinates using the floor function. This gives us the bottom left corner of the quad. The other corners can now be calculated by adding 1 to the respective axes. Now that we know the coordinates of the corners of the quad, we can get the height at each corner. What we do next is called bilinear interpolation. First, we want to get the height at the two endpoints of this green line. So we calculate factor x, which is the fractional part of the x component. And then to get the height, we just need to interpolate along the top and bottom edges separately by multiplying the factor by the delta in heights and adding the result to the height on the left. You can see that when the factor is close to 0, the result will be closer to the height on the left, and when the factor is almost 1, the result will be closer to the height on the right. Now that we have the two heights on the edges of the green line, we do the same interpolation along the z. We calculate factor z in the same way, and we use the same formula to get the final height at the camera location. Now this will give us the height sort of at the ground level, so you probably want to offset this by the height of the character, which can be, you know, like a dwarf in Lord of the Rings or Optimus Prime. Before we jump to the implementation, I'd like to mention a different method by ThinMatrix, which I found as I was researching for this tutorial. You can find the link to his video in the video description below. He finds the specific triangle where the camera is located, instead of just the quad. And then he performs barycentric interpolation between the vertices of this triangle. Now you could argue that this approach better matches the fact that we are actually rendering two independent triangles for each quad. I tend to prefer the bilinear method because I think it creates a smoother effect, but I haven't tried the alternative, so you are encouraged to play with the two methods and decide what works best for you. Don't forget to let me know the results in the comments below. So we start with the code here, in the keyboard callback method. We provide a key to the camera, which tells us whether it actually changed the position. And if it did, we call constrain camera to terrain. And this function passes along the position of the camera to the terrain in a function called constrain camera position to terrain. This function returns the new camera position, which is now supposed to be on the ground. And we put it back into the game camera. Constrain camera position to terrain starts by making sure that the camera doesn't go outside of the terrain itself in terms of the X and the Z. You can see that we make sure that the X and Z are always positive and also that they don't go beyond the size of the world. Next we call getWorldHeight, which gets us the correct height at this specific location. This is set back into the Y component of the camera, which is returned back to the caller. And we also add the camera height, which is some offset from the ground, which you can tune for yourself. GetWorldHeight divides the X and Z by the world scale. Remember, because the height map doesn't have any idea that we have scaled up the world. Okay, so this gives us the X and Z inside the height map. And now we call get height interpolated with the same coordinates, only that now they match the height map. And this function implements the formula that we saw. First, we get the height at the bottom left corner of the quad where the camera is located in. And then we get the height at the other three corners, right? By adding 1 to X or Z accordingly. We calculate factor X by subtracting the whole part of X from X itself. Okay, so this can go from 0 to 1. And then we calculate the interpolated height on the bottom and top edges by getting the delta in heights between the right corner and the left corner, multiplying by the factor and adding the left corner. Now that we have these guys, we can do the same thing along the Z. Okay, factor Z is calculated in the same way, and we use the same formula to get the final height. One final touch that I want to add is a vertical movement to sort of mimic walking. It's easier to see this when the terrain is flat. This is accomplished by combining the sine function on the X component of the camera position and the cosine on the Z component. The result is a wave-like movement which even seems a bit random. In addition, I multiplied both X and Z by 4, otherwise the result is not noticeable enough. And finally, I divided the result by 35 to make it less jumpy. This of course must be added to the Y component of the camera position. Feel free to experiment with these settings and find what works best for you. So that's it for today. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.